I'm Sabaa Tahir.
I'm Tomi Adeyemi.
And we're here to interview each other about all the things we don't yet know.
Yeah.
Yes, so.
I have a question for you.
Yes.
So this is gonna come from a student told me about the phrase gently stalking, and I was like, I'm gonna use that because that sounds much better than I read every interview you ever thing, and I looked up everything, and I looked up your articles. So when I was greatly inspired by you, and not just by your story, but also like your path and like the way you kind of broke out onto the scene, and I was gently stalking you. I was trying to learn from like decisions you'd made and maybe things that I couldn't see but could infer from. And so you also had this thing where, you know, people were so excited about an ember. So you've gone through that journey. So what's it like to go through that, but then also to come back with a sequel and now to come back with a third book? Because I think we're kind of used to like, oh, this big, big splashy new book. So what was that like for you? But then what was it like to come back and to be doing it like with a torch and with a reaper at the gates?
No, that's such a good question. I think that big part of it is loving the story so much that you don't want to fail.
Yeah.
Right? Like loving your character so much and having this understanding that these characters mean so much to a lot of people. And they mean so much to people who have never had characters who meant that much to them, right? Because they look like them.
Yeah.
Or they reflect something in them that they maybe don't get to see very often. So it was sort of like, there was a big part of me that was like, don't screw this up, Sabaa. You know, like, don't mess it up. But it was also having, you know, knowing from the beginning that this is four books.
Yeah.
Having kind of the arc planned out in my head, knowing where each character ends up. And really, it's just the puzzle of,
so you knew from beginning to end.
Yes.
Because I think once an interview quote I read from you was like, I know every moment of these characters' lives. And I was like, I'm so inspired and jealous that you have all the answers.
Well, I do. That's the thing. Yeah. They trick me a lot,
yeah.
Right? So in Torch, where Elias ends up in Torch, I don't want to spoil it for anyone, but where Elias ends up in Torch was a surprise.
Oh,
yeah, that was supposed to happen later. And so it happened and I was like, oh, book three is going to be really hard to write, right? And a big part of that is that sometimes characters do things and you're like, don't do it. Oh, you're doing it. You know, and I'm sure you've had that experience.
Oh, yeah.
Even with Zaylee, like I could see parts in there where I was like, oh, she gave her trouble. Like,
yeah.
You know, like Zaylee's just doing her own thing.
I had all these dreams, especially, okay, I don't want to ruin anything, but there's two characters that I ship. And I was like, I see the alternate story. I have like fan fiction of like what I wish could happen because I think you get to the point where you're like, I could do this, but I know this is the better story.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And you're like, I have to sacrifice, like whether it's being like, okay, there shouldn't be a bunch of scenes where she's playing with cheetahs, you know, whether it's something
right.
like that, or whether it's like, I think you guys would be really cute together
right.
and you have really cute kids and like, you can see, you're like, but I'm going to sacrifice that because I know this is the story.
And that's the thing, is that I think that when you love the characters, when you've been in the story for so long, when it's your world, and then when you go into the writing again, you have to turn everything else off, right? In a way, you have to be like, okay, the first book came out, that's done. Now I'm in the writing cave and I'm doing this. And I had to do that with Torch and I did it again with Reaper. But writing, I mean, you know this, you've written other books before Children of Bone, like writing doesn't get any easier.
I actually had to, like, the reason I was, part of it was deadlines are real.
Yes,
when I was like, I need to write the first draft of book two before book one comes out. And I had like about a month to do it. Cause I didn't know what, I turned in the final text of Children of Blood and Bone in December of 2017, like mid-December. And then January 1st, 2018, I had to start thinking about book two. And then February I had to write it. But part of the reason I was like, you have to do this now, whether or not any of these words make sense, is because I didn't want to, I'm really bad at shutting it off.
Right.
So I was like, I literally need to have like nothing else in there before I can go there. Because especially like with book three, I've known exactly where it's going. So it wouldn't be easy to sway me. But with book two, I didn't know until January because I couldn't figure it out.
Right.
And so I was like, okay, I need to get this out. Otherwise I'm going to have other influences in there and I don't want someone being like, I really like this, and suddenly there's a whole 200-page arc that was like, I'm like, where did this come from?
Yeah, exactly.
Because people are like, how do you do it? I was like, you can't I was like, you can't have anything. I was like, you have to, because that's how the story, that's how book one came out.
Right.
So you don't suddenly want to have all of these new voices and opinions and theories influencing book two, because it's really easy to be like, where did this come from? Let's try it out. This is not what I wanted. I've wasted 3 months.
Yeah, no, and I think that definitely, that's definitely a fear for me. So, you know, it's like knowing what readers might want, what fans want. It's why I don't read reviews. I'm not going to read them. If they're trade reviews, maybe, as long as they're not bad.
Yeah, I was like.
Yeah, I'm like, if they're good, I'll read it.
Yeah.
But it just, it kind of occludes so much, right? Like I have a hard time then sort of refocusing and not thinking, well, you know, this particular review said this,
that
maybe
actually
I should.
Happened to me. Really? Like it was okay. Right before I turned in the final draft and I had read this one thing and it was literally like 4.5 stars out of 5. But like, you know, we are immigrant children.
Yep.
So I was like, why isn't it 6 out of 5?
There is no 98%.
Yeah, I was like,
always 100%.
Yeah, I was like, it's that or like you failed and you should go back and try again. So like it was a very positive review and there was just one sentence that was like, here's the only thing I could comment on. And I was just like, but then when I was editing, and it wasn't supposed to be edited, it was like final pass. So I was really just making sure everything I had said to be changed was changed. But I couldn't stop myself from revising. And that's when I was like, I literally can't look at anything positive or negative. Or I was like, or these books won't get done. Because I can't help. Like, I was like, if there's some little weakness there or something that could be better, even if there's a sentence that could be better, it'll haunt me. So I was like, okay, no, nothing.
Covers are sort of a fascinating thing, how people attach so much meaning to them and so much weight, and I get it. I really
and
do.
And your cover is shit, so what was the process like for that?
It was, I mean, it, you know, I knew that they wanted to reject it. It was just something, like, Penguin does it, and it's paperbacks coming out. And it was mid-series, and I actually had no idea what a big reaction people would have for having a mid-series.
I was surprised, too. I didn't know. What? I was like, you know, the words are the same, right?
Right. It was really fascinating, but I think people are just like, well, I want my books to match. And I didn't.
But then I was like, then get the new paperbacks.
Right. But it was strange because I didn't get that. And yet, for me, it was like all about sort of having this girl on the cover. You know, the Ember cover was really the one that set the tone for everything else, right? So getting that first cover right and having this South Asian woman, clearly a South Asian woman on the cover, a brown woman, it's a fantasy book, making sure that like she's there, she's front and center, and she's looking right at you. You know, I think that that was
I think an Ember is my favorite. Like, I love them all together. Yeah, but they Ember's, look so good together when you're talking to about a match set, guys. Like, this looks really good. But yeah, when I saw that, I was like, it breathed new life into the story for me and new excitement. And I'm like, oh my God.
Yeah, there's just something really, really cool about that cover. And so I'm looking at it going, oh my goodness, like, you know, my niece is gonna see this, you know, and she's gonna see someone who looks like her on the cover, and, you know, my family in Pakistan is gonna see this, and they're gonna see somebody who looks like them, and little Sabaa is like, who's that?
Freaking
that's a cool
out,
looking book.
Yeah.
Like, there's a brown girl on the cover. And then, you know, so many people who are like, well, I completely support that. I mean, including people who are people of color, right?
Yeah.
I completely support them, but my books don't match. And, you know, and it was just like, it was very jarring for me. But, you know, that's...
It's funny, I even missed that, too. When I heard that, I was like, who's saying what to Sabaa? And they will go through me.
Tell me it's my bodyguard, man. Yeah, you better watch out.
I'm like, I'm not chill, but I'm like mostly chill. But then someone like does something to someone that I like a lot.
Yeah.
And then I'm like a raging bear.
Yeah, no, I feel that. Yeah.
That will then hibernate afterwards, like with honey, and be like, I've defended my cubs and stuff.